Okay, good day, everyone. The objective today is to give you a brief overview of the small ruminant net carbohydrate and protein system biology within the NDS platform. So probably many of you already know that NDS and the CNCPS cattle. So just to give you a brief overview for those of you also that don't know the cattle CNCPS. So the system for small ruminants is based on the structure of the original CNCPS for sheep. Okay. Subsequently, the system evolved into the small ruminant nutrition system, and then it was designed to evaluate diets and performance allowed both by sheep and goats. Okay, so obviously the sheep came first, and everything that was done for the goats was an adaptation, with the very important adjustments to the sheep system. Now the goal for the small ruminant NCPS is basically to predict energy, protein requirements and utilization, feed biological values and diet nutrient supply for young and adult animals, obviously adjusted to environmental inputs. So this is what we already do for the cattle CNCPS. And it does include predictive capability for milk yield and body weight gains and losses for all the animal types. Now, the requirements submodel is basically based on all the research done by these two guys, so Antonello Cannas and Luis Tedeschi, who dedicated their whole life to small ruminants. So their research of the last 15, 20 years has been implemented in the NDS small ruminant. And the requirements are calculated through factorial method. That means that each function has its own estimation, and then all those functions are added to each other, assuming no interactions between those functions. Obviously, we know that things are a little bit more complex. We already know that from cattle, but as you know, research in small ruminants is much less than large ruminants. So for now, we have a relatively simple factorial method to estimate requirements. The supply submodel is very similar to what we have in the cattle system. So carbohydrates and proteins are broken down into fractions, and each of them has a rate of fermentation and a rate of degradation and a rate of passage. So obviously, the main difference between a dynamic and a static system. So for those of you that have been using mainly a static system for small ruminant, they will realize that this is the biggest difference that they will encounter when using the NDS for small ruminants. So what is degraded or fermented in the rumen depends mainly between the competition of the two, rate of degradation and rate of passage. So without going into too many details, basically, the system is very similar to what we have in the CNCPS for larger ruminants, so in NDS for cattle. So with the carbohydrate fractions or protein fractions, then they're going to be fermented in the rumen. Within the rumen submodel, they're going to result in NFC and FC bacteria that have obviously different requirements. Then there is an escape for NFC, for FC, microbial production, obviously, and escape protein. There is also a lipid submodel as for the cattle system. And then obviously they all have intestinal digestibility. Then they're gonna be driving the metabolizable energy, metabolizable protein, each partition to the various functions. So with this sequence, so maintenance, pregnancy, growth, milk, and reserves. And then finally, there is going to be also the estimation of the recycled nitrogen, which is a very complex issue also for the CNCPS larger ruminants. So just a few differences between the large and small ruminants. So the main thing is, you know, one of the main factors is that the passage rates are different. So we know that smaller ruminants have a much faster rate of passage. And sometimes, you know, that can be 4 to 5 times the one that bovine have. So you see here that the KP is a function of intake, forage content, body weight, and that there is an adjustment for NDF intake as a percentage of body weight. And obviously each component of a pool, so each fraction of a feedstuff is assumed to pass at the same rate. Then intestinal digestibility is much higher than the cattle system, so it's set at 20%. I remind you that it's set at 5% for bovines. Then for those, you know, people interested in efficiency or greenhouse gas emissions, there is also a total fecal excretion and methane emissions estimation. And obviously for those of us interested more in growth, there is also an estimation for growth weight composition. Then for ruminal pH, things are also a little bit different. In small ruminants, physical effective NDF is a little bit, you know, treated in a different way from a biological point of view. So instead of using that to estimate rumen pH, we use NDF intake according to an equation from 2016. And then the KD are adjusted based on the ruminal pH, especially when the pH is lower than 6.2. So there will be a drastic reduction of microbial production when we have a lower NDF in the recipe, which means, again, a lower rumen pH. Then we also have a tool to predict the dry matter intake at pasture, and we know that for smaller ruminants, pasture is much more popular than for larger ruminants, so for both for sheep and goats. And then we also have a system that partition energy according to how the user wants to partition that. And I will just give you an example later, according to the genetic prevailing purpose. So let's go from a practical point of view. Animal inputs are very similar to other to the NDS larger ruminants. So obviously animal type, and in this case, these are the animal types represented by the small ruminants CNCPS. The only thing that I want to emphasize that we also have a category for flushing ewes. There are those ewes that are, fed a specific diet just before breeding. So those animals have higher requirements, so we prefer to actually disconnect them from the lactating ewes. And then again, you can see the other group of animal, or the other types of animals for goats as well. Then for the rest, the inputs are very similar. So again, animal type, age, which again represents the mean age of the group of the animals that we are feeding. And there is a decrease in maintenance requirements for older animals. Then we have body weight. Then we have standard reference weight body condition score of 2.5. So instead of having mature body weight, in this case, we deal with this standard reference weight. So as the mature body weight is extremely important in larger ruminants, also the standard reference weight is also extremely important in determining requirements for smaller ruminants. So obviously, again, even the body condition score has its importance in this case, because obviously the composition of the gain is estimated as a percentage of fat, protein, water, and minerals when considering this standard reference weight. Then we have wool depth, clean wool production. So all of these are going to affect protein requirements especially, but they're also going to affect the cold stress requirements during winter time. Then again, current temperature, previous temperature, when we deal with the last month or the 4 weeks before the evaluation of the diet, then wind speed, then rainfall, horizontal distance, vertical distance, body condition score, which again, it can be a little bit tricky to be estimated, especially in sheep. Days pregnant, and in this case, the last 60 days of pregnancy are going to be extremely important in determining pregnancy requirements, lamb or kid birth weight, and obviously when we have twins or triplets, we need to have an idea of that, because obviously the weight, the total weight, is going to affect pregnancy, especially again in the last 60 days of pregnancy. And then milk production that can be either predicted or measured. Obviously, sometimes it's not possible to measure it, so that can be as well predicted. And then obviously milk composition, as in milk fat and milk through protein. Now, going into the dry matter intake prediction, we have used a prediction combining two research, so 2013 and 2018, and those are based on body weight, average daily gain, milk, week of lactation, and then liter weight. And as you can see, we have used some adjustments very recently published that allow basically merging the dry and the lactating animals and having this actually very nice fitted intake prediction. So in this case, for lamb liter weight lower than 4 or higher than 4, and the same thing is for goats. This is what you will see in NDS. Obviously, things will change based on the inputs that you put in your NDS. Then I mentioned before that the user has the control over energy partition. So what it means is that with small ruminants, there is a much wider genetic variation. And sometimes we actually cannot control, or we cannot estimate partitioning of energy and protein that well. So what happens is that we let the user choose what the more likely scenario is in each specific case. So I'll switch to NDS later, but just to give you an idea that there is the option to partition energy mainly to milk, to body weight change, or to partition energy between milk and body weight. Okay, so briefly, in the first case, so when you select milk, that means that extra energy is partitioned only towards milk yield. So you assume the body weight and body condition do not change, okay, unless the user inputs those numbers. So it's both body condition and average daily gain. So you instead select body weight change when you tell the system that all the extra energy available will be fully partitioned towards body weight gain and body reserves. Okay, so even if in this case, even if you set to zero the average daily gain and you set to not to change body condition, the system will divert some of the extra energy to those two functions. And then energy partition, when the system basically partition both energy, extra energy to both milk and growth and reserves. This means that in some proportion, both milk yield and body weight and or replacement of the reserves will actually be increased. Now the proportion, in this case, the proportion of this partition between milk and body reserves will depend on the quality of the diet. So in the sense that the higher the quality of the diet, the greater will be the proportion of the diet that goes to the reserves, actually, instead of milk yield. So we also have within NDS a grazing tool, which enables us to quantify the daily dry matter intake for both sheep and goats that are grazing and that are offered different level of the basal diets. So this is this tool, which is continuously in evolution, because obviously there are so many out there, so many predictions for pasture, for grazing, for small ruminants, that we have to kind of understand which one works better for us, for our purposes. But I was saying that in this case, and I will swap to NDS very quickly now, just to give you an idea of how things work. Okay. Now let me go to NDS for just a second. So in this case, I have two recipes open for small ruminants. So one is for lactating ewes, and in this case, as I mentioned before, we have the usual animal inputs, except for that standard reference weight body condition 2.5. Also in this case, we have we need to control the change that we expect or that we target for body condition scores, and then obviously lamb's birth weight and so on. As I said before, if you look at the charts, you're gonna see how the dry matter intake prediction is going to be. And in this case, you know, you'll have the same thing if you have a dry ewe like this one. So with obviously the decrease of the last 60 days before calving of dry matter intake. Now, if you we go back to the recipe, obviously if you already know NDS, the setup is extremely similar, with the biggest difference given by those productive scenarios that I gave you before. So again, these work only if you have extra energy available. So if you have ME and MP positive. So in this case, you see that I have selected the milk productive scenarios. Extra energy and extra protein available. So I go to the productive scenarios. I swap to body weight change. So what I'm telling the system is that actually these animals might not be genetically selected only for milk, but also for body weight change. That means that they will have an allowable ME, allowable MP milk, slightly less than what I actually have inputted, and the extra energy and protein will be diverted to, will be partitioned to body weight. On the other hand, if I select energy partition, I'm telling the system that these are dual purpose animals, so they will select both the extra energy and protein to both milk and reserves. And again, that partition depends on the quality of the diet. So the higher the digestibility, the higher the quality, the higher the energy and protein that will be partitioned to reserves. Obviously, every time you select on this side of the screen, and then you swap to the NCPS tab, things will be also reflected here. Yeah, that's basically it for the recipe screen. And then remember that if I have to use the grazing tool, obviously I need to tell the system that these animals are grazing. Okay, so in the activity, you will have to select grazing. So I go back to the recipe, and there is one extra thing that I will need to do. So I'm telling the system that this is a partially mixed ration. So you see here PMR will appear. So in this case, the PMR is 1.7 kg. But I will also tell the system that there is this ryegrass that will not be part of the wagon. Okay, so that means that animals will graze this fresh ryegrass. So right now I have about 300 grams in dry matter grazed by these animals. So in the evaluation of the CNCPS, or the CNCPS evaluation, sorry, will include these 300 grams. And when I go to the grazing tool, it's a very simple tool that requires very simple inputs. So I'll have to have an idea of the herbage mass, so of the biomass available. And there are systems to measure that biomass. So for example, there are disc meters that allow to measure that, or I can just chop and measure a certain specific amount of herbage to have an idea. And I can use the default numbers, or I can also change those numbers. And again, the units in this case is ton of dry matter per hectare. I will also have to have an idea of how many hours these animals spend grazing, and the pasture height. In this case, is in centimeters, but we do realize that we'll have to have also the English system adjusted to inches, if you wish. So I think I'm done with this, and just to make you realize that the system will give you an estimation of what is the presently intake of the fresh ryegrass that these animals might ingest when they spend their 4 hours grazing. The system will also give you what is the potential of the dry matter intake from that herbage mass if those animals were given much more hours grazing. So I have to have, basically, I will have to choose in my recipe, I will have to choose a number that is, you know, between 300 grams and 1.7, depending on the number of hours that those animals spend grazing. I can, you know, choose to get the grazing data, meaning that the system will get this number and use it in the diet, as it's done in this case.
Yeah, thank you, Miliana. Thanks for going over that and stepping through the small ruminant module with us. I just wanted to make sure that we had a good basic description of how it works and the biology behind it. So thank you very much. We appreciate your time, and look forward to bringing more of these to the YouTube channel and to users. Thanks a lot for your time.
Yep, thank you.
Welcome to the NDS Professional YouTube series. Today, we're focusing on the small ruminant model, looking at goat nutrition, dairy goat nutrition, and possibly some meat goat nutrition. Today's guest speaker is Jacob Copeland of Ohio. He runs his own dairy nutrition business, Arborvale Dairy Goats Nutrition, and he currently lives in Ohio, and is also the manager of the dairy operations at The Ohio State University. His education and background are with Ohio State University, looking at small ruminant nutrition, and he has a master's degree in dairy nutrition. So with that, we welcome Jacob to go over some dairy goat nutrition ration balancing with NDS. Jacob, it's all yours.
All right, thank you, Kurt. So I think it's nice to meet you guys and kind of go over a little bit of what I do and what I look for in some of these dairy goat farms I work with. So I was asked just to kind of go over a little bit of some of the herds I work with, what I look for, and kind of how I go about kind of looking at rations and how I might change some things. So right now, you can see my screen of my NDS. I'll kind of have two rations here. I have an early lactation and a late lactation. Kind of typical with most farms I work with is I work with just three rations, early, late, and dry. So start with my early, of course. This is a very typical diet. Now, can you guys see that? Is that up close enough?
Yep, you're good.
Okay. So very typical. Most farms I work with just feed a dry hay. And then with kind of typical Midwest ingredients, you know, usually corn. I like to keep corn in my diets, part whole, part ground. Still playing with a little bit of how fine we want that corn ground. I use a lot of soy hull pellets, roasted beans, and oats are kind of in and out of some diets, just depending on the price and who actually has that available. I usually just put in oils because oils differ from feed mill to feed mill, and then my mineral. Now, this specific diet, I'll kind of jump over to my other screen of some production on here. Now, I don't have a lot of farms that do DHI, so, you know, if you have people have goats, you know, try your hardest to get DHI. And the most important one for me, especially for milk production, is the MUNs. This is a very typical farm of what I work with. I have, you know, a handful of them that it looks just like this throughout the year. You know, when we look at our lactation numbers, let's see here. So when you look at average daily milk, now this is an Alpine breeder, so they have all purebred Alpines. It's very typical to see your first lactations are going to be producing between 5 and 7 pounds. 5 and 8 pounds is a very, if you can get an 8 pounds for your herd, that's good. Second lactation, you're hitting, you should be hitting 10, 12. In your third lactations, you should be hitting, you know, if you're Alpines or Saanens, you should be getting in that 13 to 18 pound range. I have goats at home. Right now, my second lactations are at about 12. And currently, I don't have anything over third lactation because I'm starting over. But last year, all three of my third lactations were producing about 16, 17 pounds. So you can get these goats producing a lot of milk. Fat, this herd's actually doing really good on her protein and fat. A lot of times, if you can get a 3-1, you know, and a 4-7 fat, that's kind of typically what I aim for. And I'll show you that when I go through when I start a herd. But I just want to show you this as a general overview of what I see throughout the year. So for this is her DHI for all of pretty much 2021, and then the start of this year. When I'm doing any of my rations for early lactation all the way through mid, I like to see my MUNs at about 26. 26 to 28. If they go over 28, I try to back off a little bit. But if I see it under, I like to try and kind of increase my protein a little bit in this diet. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of what we're looking at as far as milk yield components and where I like to see MUNs. There's not a lot of data on this, so we're always kind of looking to see how we can compare. You know, with these small ruminants, especially with herds producing what they are today, we really just don't have a lot of data. But, you know, the more we get, the better we can kind of tweak these rations. So just starting off, you know, your basics of balancing a ration, your inputs, a lot of inputs for these, you know, dairy breeds, you know, Alpines and Saanens, like I said, there's not a huge difference between here. However, I usually always, there's a huge range of size in, just like kind of in dairy cows. If I'm going on a new farm, I usually go by size, by breed. So if I'm doing Alpines or Saanens, I'm doing 130, 140, which should be about right. Not many people weigh their goats. It's hard to get someone to even use a weight tape on these animals. My goats, just as a reference, you know, they're weighing, I have Saanens and they're about 160. So they're, you know, a little bit on the higher side. Now, milk production, I have found that for my higher producing goats, I always put my milk production at about 10 pounds. Even if they're producing, just using these rations, a safe bet is you balance for 10, you're going to be losing about 0.03 pounds a day. And this is a good start as to how you want to just look at balancing a ration for these goats. Fat, you should be going, 4 to 4.5. If this was a Nubian, I'd probably put this at 4.5. Protein about the same. Alpines and Saanens, you're going to want to put it at about 4%. And that's with everybody I've been working at, I found that just to be about true. I don't put anything in for MUNs. This is something that's last year I've been getting more data. So I'm not really for me personally using this program, I haven't really utilized putting in this point. It's just something I kind of look at on DHI sheets. Body condition scoring. I don't know about a lot of people out there using this module or working with dairy goat producers, but I have found an extreme variation in how people body condition score. And most people don't really know how to body condition score a goat. I've been out to farms where they say, oh yeah, they're all, 3.5s, and they're 2.25, but Saanens, Alpines, they're a very hairy breed. Nubians are really fleshy. People don't, just personal experience. What I try and do is, if I'm out of farm, I do it myself. Most farms keep, about 3 to 3.5 is just typically where I like to keep it. I found a better way to gauge this is just by early mid lactation, they're always losing 0.02 to 0.03. And then that should just, that should level out. One huge difference I find working between dairy cow farms and dairy goats is most dairy goats breeders are seasonal just because of the way that the goats are kind of seasonal breeders. So you have a one-time shot. You're balancing for a group. And then you kind of work that group, and then you learn from that entire lactation. Working on these dairy cow farms, you have this constant flow, so you can constantly be tweaking. It's a little bit harder on these dairy goat farms because sometimes it feels it's a one shot deal. If you start them off bad, it carries over through the whole lactation, and then you have to start over the next year. So in that instance, I've found it harder. But this is typically how I start with a farm. The bad thing is usually people call you during this early lactation when they have problems. So sometimes this is a farm I've already been working with. So sometimes I'll drop this down lower and I expect to try and, you're kind of correcting issues. So it is hard, but just overall, this is kind of how I start with the herd. I haven't messed with much with the environmental side of things. I don't know, and maybe Kurt can answer me or David here, but with the dairy goats module, messing with these numbers hasn't really affected how I balance a ration. For me, it's more on the looking at that data. Here in Ohio, you can get really hot for a couple months and kind of humid, and then it goes away. But I don't know if one of you guys can address that a little bit, but I don't know how the inputs work really with the environmental side of it. I haven't really used it all that much. All right, so jumping back to my early lactation ration, see if I can kind of coming over here on the right, just looking at overall diets. Actually, before I start there, I'll look at my dry matter intakes. I have found that typically my dry matter intakes on farms, I feel, now I don't have good solid data to, you know, really address the, you know, exactly what they're eating. But I think it's a little bit higher, these high, you know, these animals that are producing a lot than what the actual predicted amount is. So I typically go about a half a pound to three quarters of a pound higher on my dry matter intake while doing these early, you know, these kind of mid-lactation, high-yielding dairy goats. And I found this to be, you know, even on my own farm, when I look at how much I go through, is about what I feel is about right. So what I tend to do is I'll balance a ration where they're eating about 3.5 to 4 pounds of a grain mix. Like I said, most of my diets are, it's hay and grain. So you're parlor feeding grain, and then you're feeding a dry hay. I don't feed really any TMRs for dairy goats. I feed more of the TMRs for meat goats. So I don't go over 4 pounds on grain, and then I kind of split that you know, with my hay. Now, if I'm just looking at a, now this ration's already balanced, so I'm not really correcting anything, but pretty typical, I'm usually at about a little over 17% protein. You know, I'm split 50-50 with my forages and my grain mixes. Depending on the hay, I do go up to 60% grain. Goats seem to have a lot less problems with acidosis as long as you keep that forage. Even with parlor feeding, I found if you're going to that 60% range, you know, there are people who are feeding that grain three times a day. This diet specifically, they're being parlor fed and they're being milked twice a day. RDP with my dairy goats. When I balance a ration for my dairy cow farms, I usually have that at about 10. Dairy goats is, like I said, there's not a lot of data out there on this, but I aim for a little bit higher, you know, not much. You know, if they're between 10 and 12, I'm happy. Fat, this is a little bit lower actually on the ether extract than I would, you know, typically do. The hay is, you know, is a little deep, is better here, but I'll feed anywhere from, you know, 5 to 8% fat on these high dairy goat rations. You can really see, and this is something that, you know, you have your unsaturated fats and your saturated. You could feed quite a bit of a high unsaturated fat diet to a dairy goat and not see that milk fat depression like you'll see in dairy cows. I did a lot of looking at that comparison between goats and cows when I did my master's degree. And unless you're feeding fish oil to a dairy goat, you really shouldn't see very harmful, like much effect, unless you have, you know, a kind of a bad diet. Now starch, with most of my herds, my starch is typically lower than you would see with dairy cows. I'm usually running 20 to 23 in general. I don't have many diets where I'm feeding more than that. Unless, you know, unless corn's, you know, really cheap and you just have, if you're growing your own corn, I might, like I have one, you know, person who actually grows their own corn and I have it up at 28, but that's just more for the cost than anything else. But I think you can go higher. I know you can go higher, but typically what I feed tends to be in that, you know, 21 to 25% range. And that, a lot of that's because you are feeding a lot of that dry hay. I'll kind of go down to the, instead of looking at actual minerals in the diet, I'll look at the minerals of how it's balanced. Most things on here I feel are pretty good as you balance the rations. Copper is one that if I have a complete confinement herd, I keep it right at that level. If if I have ones that are pastured, there's a lot of other variations out on pasture. You have a higher parasite load. I will actually take the copper up to about 140% of what, you know, NDS will say is required. That is needed for, you know, a lot of immunologic properties of the dairy goat. And so that there is shown that you do need more of that depending on the environment that the goat's at. Other thing with parasites and goats, this is all confinement, but animals that are out on pasture, and this is with not just goats, but with some of the sheep as well. I do a lot of stuff at a research center at OSU. We actually feed about 20%, 25% over requirements when animals are out on pasture. If you know you are going to have parasite problems, and here in Ohio, you just have to count on it. It's not between the deer and just grazing. And I think there is some research out there on that specific subject. Hold on, I'm having some computer issues. I guess a couple other things I'll just kind of touch on. When looking at DCAD, I don't think I've found any research on DCAD in goats. It's just all on dairy cows. But I think it kind of, whatever holds true with dairy cows is kind of, I think most of my DCAD on my dairy goats are at that, you know, 25, 26. But again, there's not a lot of research on that. So it's kind of hard to speak on the validity of the differences between the dairy goats and dairy cows. Let's see. Is there anything else, Kurt or David, that you want me to kind of touch on as far as just getting the basics of how I do this?
I think that's a good overview. I was curious, being the fiber guy myself, what you see out there is the quality of the forage improves or worsens, how you change the diet at all.
So for a lot of the dairy goat people there, let me pull up this forage analysis. So I found this is a pretty normal hay that we're feeding. What I find is if we get too much, I find more of an effect on these meat goats, and I'll pull up one of those rations. But if you get your ADF too high, I'll see what this one's about 35. So if you're getting a really mature, I think, you know, I like to keep it under this for your forages. Let me see if I can close this out. My diet's only at, you know, 24 with the grain. Let's see if I can pull up a meat goat diet.
When you're talking ADF, are you more concerned with the energy level of the feed or the kind of the gut fill? Do you see intake being affected?
More the gut fill. I find that it seems like the effect is more on the intake. You know, goats have a very, and there's not a lot of data on this either, but you know, your pasture rate is going to be really a lot faster. You should be able to maximize your microbial protein with goats a lot more so than you would a dairy cow. But in my mind, I think when you get too coarse, too much ADF that you're slowing down that flow rate, and it can kind of has more of an effect, I think, with these dairy goats. Let's see. I had a guy, he's a meat goat. Guy, and he was feeding a very, just hearing pull up his hay. Let's see, I must not have. Anyway, he was feeding more on the kind of a, 30% of the diet. And there is some research out there with ADF and goats. And if you get above that 27 mark, I believe is what kind of we were looking at, you start to drastically decrease your intake. Okay, I think it's this guy. And on this farm.
And that's what tweaking.
Yeah, there it goes. Go ahead. It's going slowly. So originally, this guy was at about 30% ADF in his diet. And he was only, his intakes were only about 2.3, 2.4. This has changed some of his grass. But now we only, the highest we got, he was feeding just really kind of rough haze. But when we decrease this number to about 26, 25, let's see if I can pull up one of the newer ones. We got about a half a pound more intake off these animals. There was nothing else we can really do with the hay he was feeding. It was just that was what he was using. But I found on a few farms, for the meat goats specifically, it's like the opposite of the dairy. We're actually predicting more on the intakes, and I don't think with both my, like all five of my farms, the intake on these guys are barely hit over three. This guy was really low, but like I said, his, let me see if I can pull up another ration of his.
Do you have see a lot of alfalfa in your diets there? Are you feeding any grass? When you mentioned reducing ADF, I was wondering how you do that.
Yeah, so I usually I find getting some of that alfalfa out, and I'll have some guys feeding that kind of more of an orchard grass type hay. I've been to a lot of places, and that's the problem with feeding alfalfa too. It varies farm to farm, but even here at my house, I feed like an alfalfa grass mix. They will leave, my goats will leave a lot of the leaves and a lot of the, that softer stuff. And it just piles in the bunks, and they don't really eat a lot of it. I actually take a lot of that stuff at the bottom, like the leaves and the stuff that's going to be, a lot of your nutrition's in there. And I actually mix it back into some of my grain batches and feed it back. But then other farms, they clean it up. I'm not sure. That's been a tough one. Okay, so this was the final diet that. So he was at about 20. I think he was at about originally, like he was like 28, something almost up to 29. And I just kind of messed with some of his he had a couple different, you know, he's feeding earlage. He has a conglomerate of feeds he was using. So it went from 2.4 and his dry matter intake went to about 3 is where we were sitting at with him. And we decreased his ADF about 3%, which, funny enough, when I was looking at some research, that's just about where, you know, as much of a change as we would have thought. You know, compared to the research, I probably should have seen more of a change, but, you know, research sometimes is, you maximize the change. But I look more, I notice when I work with the dairy goats and meat goats, I look more at that ADF number for looking at intake. And sometimes, you know, just in general for the digestibility of that hay, than I would with my dairy cow rations. But then again, I'm using a lot more dry hays and balages with these goats than I am. You're not feeding silages, really, like chopped silages with dairy goats typically.
I'm curious how you manage the level of fiber from a kidding goat, you know, through that transition.
Through kidding?
Yeah, kidding to fresh to.
So that's one area that, so as I kind of said, you know, we typically, you know, you have a early lactation ration, and then kind of, you know, mid and then dry. With goats, I've seen a lot of bad diets with these goats. Unless it's really bad, you don't really have many transition issues. So normally, that early lactation ration that I make, depending on the body conditions for these goats, I typically have them start feeding that grain just to kind of get them going, you know, about a couple weeks before they freshen. And then really it's, you know, you have your free choice hay, and then you're just kind of building that grain up as almost like a transition diet, not necessarily a pre-fresh diet. And that's really, I haven't had any transition issues with the goats. It's really hard to, and maybe some people disagree, but I found it's really hard unless you really got bad management versus the nutrition, having these transition issues. And really it's just it's a slow increase of their intake naturally versus you're trying to get them through that, you know, that pre-fresh period. You know, you're not having DAs. I've, you know, known a few herds that had a DA on their, you know, goats, but it's very few and far between. We just don't have the issues with goats as we do with our dairy cows.
So I have one question for you. So going back to the lactation diet, and this is a new feature that they've put in. Probably should have talked to you about that before, but under, you know, where you're listing your 10 and 12 pounds, he's put that production scenario where he has milk in there, kind of a new tab right down below there. Have you seen this?
Oh, here.
And this is something we'll cover over there, but I think the old system that was used was always looking at, milk production was set, and then you would manipulate that by body change. And so now what I think he's trying to do is look at, the energy partitioning of, you know, looking at how much milk is that going to be on the ME and the MP prediction with the energy body weight changes that can be calculated there. So if you click, I think that energy partition tab, and then go back to the CNCPS page. Yeah, right there. So I think he's trying to show some of that where the old system was a little static, and it'll be interesting to look at that. But like you said, it's hard to get body weights, and you know, even on some of our big dairies now that are coming through rotaries, we're just now getting some body weights, you know, post-calving body weight losses and stuff. But anyway, yeah. I just wanted to touch base on that.
I hadn't really messed with that that part of it before. So that'll be kind of interesting to... Yeah, so that drops the energy a little bit. Keeps the protein.
Yeah, and then... There we go. That would be interesting to see as far as, so yeah, looking at the 7 point, and so the milk fluctuates, the milk and the body weight change, as you can see, and then predicting energy partitioning. So yeah, that's awful interesting. It is really interesting, Jacob, that we're starting to get people with data. So that is phenomenal. So, wow, I really appreciate your time and going through this with us. Kurt, do you have any other questions? And if not, we'll.
I think that's good. Thank you very much.
All right.
No, you're welcome. Hopefully I'll get some more stuff for you guys.
Appreciate it. Appreciate
learning one day at a time.
Appreciate your expertise.